activating the feeling sense, becoming more childlike, allowing those younger ego states to emerge, generates more sensitivity to the touch of the world upon us, and the hard shell of our older self begins to dissolve. And when you do that, because our childlike self, the sensory gating channels are a lot more open. So just doing that, they automatically get more open. You start being more childlike again. You know, and a lot of people, you know, some reductions will say, well, you can't go back to childhood, you're just being childish. You know, and you're like, screw you. You know, if I needed a parent, I'd go home to visit my mother, but I'm not going to sit around with you. You know, and it's like childish and childlike is not the same. You've got Einstein, you've got all of these really cool people that were very childlike. Use them as models. I mean, and then just look at some of those reductionists, how unhappy they are in their body. You know, it's like you can choose whatever. You can do whatever you want. You're grown-ups. You don't have to settle for less. So, and opening that, the sensory gating channels, it just gives you more access into the world. And you start building a new skill base. And to touch on your question, we naturally encounter not only the beauty and everything that's out there to be encountered, but we learn to walk in mysteries. I love that. And shadowed luminosity. To find out what's really there for ourselves. Okay. We find all kinds of things out there. And the world is a lot more interesting than anything that you've been taught. And I'll give you some real brain wobbles today about stuff like that, especially this afternoon. So I'm going to talk about deep intelligence in the Gaian system today. A lot of times, you know, I don't like the word evolution. I actually hate it because evolution means to get better. That's what, you know, it doesn't matter what the dictionary says. That's what everybody, it's like, oh, I was in the bar the other night and I sat down, this fellow sat down next to me, and he wasn't evolved at all. He was just terrible. I had to listen to the most terrible jokes. You know, and then of course, if the guy's fun, he'll tell you the terrible jokes endlessly until you go, yeah, the guy sucked. So I like the word innovation. Gaia innovates over and over and over again on a theme. Gaia self-organized, something more than the sum of the parts has come into being. And like all self-organized systems, Gaia constantly improves its capacity to remain self-organized. And over time, it increases the complexity in the system. Okay. The more subunits there are, the more intelligences there are working to analyze inputs and generate responses. I mean, Gaia, computer, it's like we understand sort of what computer means, and it's not really an accurate analogy, not really an accurate metaphor for this, but really Gaia creates more and more computers all of the time that can solve problems, okay? But they're living intelligences, not, you know, just a computer. And again, the responses come out of those subunits' ability to choose. So I love Richard Lewontin is a guy I particularly like. He's a professor emeritus at Harvard. He said, much of the uncertainty of evolution arises from the existence of multiple possible pathways, even when external conditions are fixed. It is a prejudice of evolutionists who give adaptive explanations of the features of organisms that every difference between species must be a consequence of different selective forces. Populations subject to identical selective conditions may arrive at quite different evolutionary endpoints, so that the observation that two species differ is not prima facie evidence they were adaptively differentiated. Basically, you plant two plants that are identical in the same location, they're going to have very different leaf structure, very different behavior, very different chemistry. It's always the way. You can't standardize herbal medicines. It's impossible. They want to because they want to make them pharmaceuticals, but that's why. Every plant you pick is going to have a slightly different composition chemically, and that's important. all plant types that exist are an illustration over that truth over long timelines. Goethe said there was only one original plant, the Erbpflanze, the original plant that emerged into this world as Gaia pulled it into being out of the ocean of being. And so it ends up here, this one plant, but as soon as it ends up in an environmental place, then it begins to shift in response to the environmental pressures on it. And each plant that we see now, we walk by miracles every day and we don't see them. Have you ever wondered, how in the hell can you tell that a plant is a plant? It doesn't matter how different it looks, right? Some plants don't even look like plants, and yet you look at them and you know it's a plant, right? Because you have that capacity of perception. You can still perceive the Erbpflanze inside of it, the original plant essence, right? So all of those plants differentiated over long timelines. Lewontin says, the characteristic of a living object is that it reacts to external stimuli rather than being passively propelled by them. An organism's life consists of constant mid-course corrections. Constant mid-course corrections. Okay. That's intelligence. They choose. The word intelligence, I love this, comes from a Latin phrase which means simply to choose. And so these innovations, if they're successful, they spread throughout the system. They're incorporated into new forms as complexity develops. A lot of people have noticed this. I love Gregory Bateson in particular. He said, every evolutionary step is an addition of information to an already existing system. Okay? So he was great. He takes it to information. I love that. The word information is key here. Each foundational step is incorporated into every addition. Every new innovation holds within it previous patterns. Because when Gaia gets a pattern that works, something that works, Gaia goes, hey, this is great, this works, and Gaia begins using it everywhere. Okay? Gaia's not stupid, although Earth system scientists would love to have it if Gaia were stupid. Because then they could feel smarter. I mean, these guys are not the sharpest tacks in the drawer, really, you know. It's not rocket surgery. There's a network of patterns that runs through everything. All self-organized systems learn as they go. Each successful response to destabilization is held in memory. Like a juggler, the more they do it, the better they get at it, okay? That experience is held in memory below the level of conscious thought. All the ways self-organization is lost is remembered. All the ways it's retained is remembered. And there's constant innovation on those rememberings, like a bicyclist, okay? Okay, first you learn how to get balanced, right? Then you do it without hands, right? Okay? So every time a useful innovation is generated, the system explores its use in other contexts. The underlying essence of the thing is adapted to other uses, and some are so successful you can find them everywhere. Okay? Developmental stages are a meta pattern. Okay? It's a meta pattern you see that runs through the whole ecosystem. All right? That's why baby ducks and baby puppies and baby kittens and baby plants, gardeners will tell you, though other people can't see it so well, baby human beings, baby birds, they all have a similarity of essence, okay? Because they all are going through the same developmental stages because, again, each one of those developmental stages represents a discrete consciousness module that is used to perceive certain aspects of the layered reality in which we're embedded. That gives you certain adaptive capabilities, okay, that are essential, that Gaia found over long evolutionary time are necessary for organisms to successfully be here and do what they do. So Gregory Bateson came up with the idea of meta patterns. He called it also the pattern that connects. PowerPoint, my friend. So if you start looking,
just a moment while the technical team is there.
So if you start looking, this is a dragon's fly wing, okay? Next one, human skin. You see the same pattern there. Next one, leaf. You see the same pattern. You can find these patterns everywhere, okay? Now, I love sex. You know, the 60s gave me sex, drugs, and rock and roll, and technically, my talk this week is about that, although I've hidden it inside larger word groups. So, the next one. Okay, at the bottom you have a flower reproductive system. At the top you have a human female reproductive system. If you really look at these in depth, you can see just even from the general shape, it's the same pattern, right? The flower reproductive system occurred first. The female reproductive system is just an innovation on that form. The next one, that's a male reproductive system. And then one of the things that it's really important to understand, with Homo sapiens sapien, there's not two species, there's one. And Gaia innovated split genders to help genome mingling, right? The male reproductive system and the female reproductive system is identical. It doesn't seem like it. It's just simply been morphed for function. Okay? Each of us possesses the capacities of the other. I am a male-female. You are a female-male. Okay? Right? We're the same. So if you understand that, you understand that the testes and the ovaries are exactly the same organ morphed for function. They're approximately the same size, okay? Very similar in their structure. The prostate and the uterus are the same organ morphed for function, okay? The clitoris elongates outward into the penis, or vice versa. When you understand this, once you understand that it's the same pattern simply morphed for function to facilitate genomic blending to keep the species more adaptively healthy, then there's an immediate, zillion immediate observations. One of them is that flowers menstruate. Okay. We call it nectar. Okay. And female menstruation serves a number of functions, but one of them is that it sterilizes the vaginal passageways to reduce infection. And what happens, and basically seminal emission, okay? The seminal, not we're not talking about the sperm now, we're talking about the seminal emissions that come out of the prostate. That functions to sterilize the passageways through the penis, right? Exactly the same way, right? So nectar fulfills the same function in the flower of sterilizing to help prevent infection. And part of it's the sugar content, but the flowers put massive numbers of secondary constituent molecules into the nectar, which are tremendously antimicrobial. That's one of the reasons why natural honey is such a potent medicine. Okay? It's not just the sugar content. And that's why the one great thing about the UK medicine is they were the first technological medical group in the world that began to use honey to treat infected surgical wounds that would not respond to antibiotics. But of course, the pharmaceutical companies got involved and said, well, you can only use this honey, meta honey, right? Which of course it costs 50 times as much, but it's really good. But there's all these chemical compounds in there that are very, very antimicrobial, right? Okay, Then for years, it's like going to all these herb conferences, and there's like, oh, plant estrogens this, plant estrogens that. You know, we all are so incredibly ignorant, and we will never not be ignorant. As soon as you come to terms with that, life gets a lot easier, all right? It took 10 years for me to ask the question, what about phytoandrogens? I can't believe it didn't occur to me. I'm so stupid. I hate that. And then when I notice it, I go, ah, God, I'm really stupid again. I don't want to be that way anymore. I want to know all things.
So what did they answer?
So, yes, there are phytoandrogens, but nobody done any work with it. So I pioneered it. See, you know, mate, I've got these calluses on my hand. It's from that. So, phytoandrogens, pine pollen has pharmaceutically pure testosterone in it, more than any other plant on the planet, plus a number of other androgens. So when guys in middle age begin experiencing lower testosterone levels, if they do pine pollen tincture, has to be the tincture, hold it in your mouth just for about a minute, and then you swallow it. None of it reaches the stomach. It's absorbed through the mucous membranes into the bloodstream. Testosterone goes up like that. Okay? And so I often refer to pines as world-class woodies. I can't help myself. But if you understand this dynamic, see, at this point in the week, I'll begin losing words quite rapidly. I'll be reduced down to like, wow, it's totally cool, you know. Gene Houston will be embarrassed about me. But molecules that affect the endocrine function, the tissue inside the uterus and the tissue inside the prostate are extremely similar. So a lot of people will use saw palmetto to work with inflamed prostate when you have prostate disease, but it will also work in the uterus, okay? Because both organs are identical, the herbs that work for one will work for the other. They just work slightly differently, okay? Well, what saw palmetto is an endocrine normalizer for tissue, okay? You won't see that in hardly any of the books. But what it does when you take it in, the tissues inside both the prostate and the uterus, they start behaving abnormally for a zillion different kinds of reasons, long story, which I'm not going to go into, but basically it normalizes those tissue structures, okay? Like echinacea does that, not for that, but if you, it tends to normalize cellular function in cells it can touch. Okay. Echinacea angustifolia, not purpurea. I hate purpurea. Okay.
Which conference did you say?
What's that?
What conference are you talking about?
Echinacea angustifolia normalizes cellular tissue it can touch. Purpurea is not as good. I don't like purpurea. Okay. But that's what the Germans innovated the use of purpurea because of the war, World War I. They couldn't get angustifolia, but purpurea grows really easily. It was in the gardens, so they began using that, right? But they don't use the root. They use the fresh juice of the stem, okay? The Native Americans in the States, even the eclectic botanical physicians, thought purpurea was useless. And I don't like it as an herb medicine. I think angustifolia or any of the others are much stronger. Anyway, Bateson said, our sense of aesthetic unity allows us to see these patterns more easily. There's a feel to them. And when we start feeling them, we begin to feel the connections that run between things where they show up. Golden threads are another way to talk about that connection. Now, neural networks are another meta-pattern. All self-organized biological systems have them. All use them to help maintain self-organization. Every self-organized biological system is highly intelligent. including bacteria. And I'm going to read some of this because nobody believes me. This is like, I can say it all day long, they still don't believe me. And this is some statements from some bacterial researchers. Bacteria possess a highly sophisticated neural network. The properties of these networks include signal amplification, associative responses, memory, learning, and the generation by individual bacteria of informed decisions. Didn't hear that in school, did you? Bacteria use their intracellular flexibility, involving signal transduction networks and genomic plasticity, to collectively maintain linguistic communication, self and shared interpretation of chemical cues, exchange of chemical message and dialogues. Meaning-based communication permits colonial identity, culture, that's what that means, detection making and the recognition and identification of other colonies, features we associate with bacterial social intelligence. They possess an inheritable colonial memory. What they learn, they pass on to their descendants. They care for and teach their offspring. Colonies have developed intricate communication capabilities, including a broad repertoire of chemical signaling mechanisms, collective activation and deactivation of genes, and even exchange of genetic materials. With these tools, they can communicate and self-organize their colonies into multicellular hierarchical aggregates out of which new abilities emerge. Colonies, multicellular hierarchical aggregates, are in fact cities that far surpass our own. Some create and use electricity, which they send through insulated cables, PowerPoint. And there is a picture. Scientists, researchers found some really extensive bacterial colonies on the bottom of the ocean that used pressure differentials to create electricity to warm their cities, which they run through that insulated cable there, which looks quite similar to our own. Of course, they developed it about 3 billion years ago. We got there more recently. Within these colonies, each bacterium has internal degrees of freedom, informatic capabilities, and freedom to respond by altering itself and others via emission of signals in a self-regulated manner. In other words, free will. James Shapiro says, he's great, 40 years experience as a bacterial geneticist have taught me that bacteria possess many cognitive, computational, and evolutionary capabilities unimaginable in the first 6 decades of the 20th century, and it's still unimaginable to most reductionists. Analysis of cellular processes, such as metabolism, regulation of protein synthesis, and DNA repair, establish that bacteria continually monitor their external and internal environments, self-organization by any other name, and compute functional outputs based on information provided by their sensory apparatus, compute. My own work on transposable elements revealed multiple widespread bacterial systems for mobilizing and engineering DNA molecules. Examination of colony development and organization led me to appreciate how extensive multicellular collaboration is among bacterial species. Bacteria utilize sophisticated mechanisms for intercellular communication and even have the ability to commandeer the basic cell biology of higher plants and animals to meet their needs. This remarkable series of observations requires us to revise basic ideas about biological information processing and realize that these tiny cells are sentient beings. Each bacterium is by itself a biotic autonomous system with its own cellular informatics capabilities. These afford the cell plasticity to select its response to incoming messages it receives, including self-alteration and the broadcasting of messages to initiate alterations in other bacteria. The take-home lesson of more than half a century of molecular microbiology is to recognize that bacterial information processing is far more powerful than human technology. These small cells are incredibly sophisticated at coordinating processes involving millions of individual events and at making them precise and reliable. In addition, the astonishing versatility and mastery bacteria display in managing the biosphere's geochemical and thermodynamic transformations indicates we have a great deal to learn about chemistry, physics, and evolution from our small but very intelligent relatives. Bacteria recognize kin. By helping a close relative reproduce, an individual transfers genes to the next generation, albeit indirectly. This class of cooperation is altruistic. Quote, cheater cells are suppressed, are inhibited, so they cannot take over a population. They stopped the bankers. We did not. Okay? Cheater cells are suppressed, are inhibited, so they cannot take over a population. Now, which one's smarter? Bacteria are just like us. It's no surprise because we are bacteria, okay? I love Paul Krugman stuff. He goes, you know, zombies, they look for brains, right? They have to have brains, you know? And so all the reductionists have taught us that we seek brains, you know? Brains are not necessary for intelligence. A neural network is necessary for intelligence. An organ that looks somewhat like the one in our heads is not necessary for intelligence. Neural networks are generated anytime a biological self-organization event occurs. The computational capabilities that we recognize as integral to intelligence naturally merges out of the collective dynamics of the network, which is nonlinear. Neural networks are a hallmark of self-organization. We are not more intelligent than all other creatures on the earth. We are not unique in our neural network. Or as Lynn Margulis once put it, our intolerant slogans continually denigrate the non-human life with which we share this planet. The problem is our brain really is not especially unique. Bacterial intelligence far surpasses our own. Bacterial ability to analyze our pharmaceuticals and then create resistant responses is far beyond anything we ourselves can do. Okay, the usual story, and I read this in the newspapers all the time. I just hate it. Okay, well, make sure you take all your medicine because, you know, now, we are going to have some resistance problems, but the reason why is while most bacteria will be susceptible to the antibiotic, there's a few that are not. Okay? And you kill off the susceptible ones, and the ones that are not susceptible then live to breed. And that's how resistant mechanisms enter our culture. The truth is, bacteria analyze the pharmaceutical and redesign their own genome. And they all do it as a group, right? Very much like those guys I mentioned yesterday that solved the protein folding problem in 10 days. They all get together and they start working on it. They share the information. And as soon as they figure out a resistance mechanism, they tell everybody. They tell all bacteria. They create little loops of DNA that they extrude out into the world that other bacteria can pick up. Anytime two bacteria meet, the first thing they share is resistance information, because that's the big news in the bacterial world. It's like, oh, these guys are trying to kill us. What did you figure out to do? This? They go, ah. They literally redesign their own genome, which creates different physical form. Okay.
Is that the morphic resonance type?
Oh, I can't get into that stuff. Now, you have to ask Rupert about that. Wait. Yeah, that's what a lot of us are saying to the bacteria. Just a second.
I thought we were all in this together, and we're bacteria. Who are the other bacteria? Are they the Viking bacteria? Like, I thought we're a collaborative and we're all in this together. So
we are in it together.
Are we supposed to get sick and die? Is that the aim of the exercise?
Yes, it is. Population problems have a horrible way of solving themselves. Okay,
so
now
we shouldn't get so frantic about, oh my God, I've got to go to the doctor, I've got to get saved.
You can if you want. I mean, that's my philosophy. When in panic, are in doubt, run in circles, scream and shout. Like, I mean, it's like if you've got cancer, like I often get, you have to do something, right? So the thing is, look, we're dealing with ecological realities too. So what researchers did, what scientists did, right? They erected a barrier around the human species, a wall made of pharmaceuticals. And every year they have to put more and more energy into that wall, right? To keep it in place. And the bacteria out there, they don't like that wall. The ecosystem doesn't like the wall, right? Okay. It allowed us to become numerous enough to create technology to perform our ecological function, which I'll talk about tomorrow. Okay. But the thing is, that wall, it's just like putting pesticides on a field. The first year it works great, second year not so good, third year they find a way through. But we keep pumping more and more energy into the wall, right, to hold it. Sooner or later the wall's going to crumble, and not too long from now. Okay. And once that happens, the bacteria will flow through the system with epidemics like we've never seen before. The point of it being to reduce population back to sustainable levels, okay?
Right.
That's it. But we're going to die anyway. It's not like if that didn't happen, we're going to live forever. You know, it's like, I mean, and that's the belief we're taught. You know, only if we have enough more research money, eventually we'll live to be millions of years old. You know, it'll be amazing, you know? And it'll just be, you know, the only reason that we die so soon is because nature is, well, it's kind of messy. And we can make it better, right? But the thing is, there's this balance in place that's been here for a long time. And the way that it happens, nobody likes to know this, but viruses and bacteria act exactly like hunting packs, and they pull down the weakest members of the group, right? That's just the way it works. It's always worked that way, always going to work that way, right? We're supposed to biodegrade. And then new stuff happens, right? So we have to learn how to not mind dying. And with my people didn't like it. It's not like they said, yeah, I get to die today. But it's like, and my great-grandfather is a doctor, they all knew it was part of it. He delivered babies at home. He sat with the people at their houses when they died. And all of the family would gather around, and they would wash the dead person, and they would have a wake, and then they would bury the person with all these ceremonies. They welcomed them into the world, and they had ceremonies for taking them out. It was integrated. Death and rebirth was integrated. Now it's all hidden away, right? As if we can make it go away. And the last thing most people want to see now is a dying person in their midst, because they're terrified of it. We're not used to seeing it, right? But death is an irremovable part of the system. And it's not true that it can be removed. It's built in. There may be a proximate initiator of death, but the cause of death is life. Okay.
So herbal medicine is for junior illnesses.
Herbal medicine, you can treat, I treat diseases a great deal more serious than...
Oh, junior, not dying.
Como?
Before, if you're going to die and the bacteria is going to get you, that's it. Herbal medicine is for illnesses that the bacteria is not ready to kill you yet.
Oh, let's change that and to say, sooner or later, our time will come. And if it's your time, it's your time. Okay. And so, I mean, I love this thing Rilke said, the German poet. He said, the sad thing is, not only do people now not live their own life, they don't live their own death. Okay. And it's an amazing journey. That's one of the reasons I worked with Elizabeth Kubler-Ross and Joan Halifax and the Symington's with terminal cancer stuff, because I wanted to be prepared to live my own death. You know, I mean, I basically, you know, truly, I want to die like, you know, my grandfather did, asleep. Not like the people in the back seat of the car he was driving, screaming. That's a pretty good one. You don't get many opportunities to segue into that joke. So I thank you. We all thank you. You know, we just added, what, 3 or 4 years to our life laughing like this. So when the bacteria intentionally generate chemicals that produce specific outcomes, that's tool making, okay? It's just as in a hammer, right? But it's very sophisticated tool making. So everything is intelligent. Everything can communicate. Everything has the capacity for mathematical differentiation. Even slime mold, which really upsets reductionists. Slime mold can actually find its way through a maze quite quickly, right? And you want to know, then, so like they did a lot of rats through mazes. You know the difference between a rat and a graduate student? So they did this study where they had a rat-sized maze and a human-sized maze, exactly the same maze. And at the end of the rat maze, they put cheese. At the end of the graduate student maze, they put a $5 bill. So they both figured the way through the maze about the same rate of speed. But the difference is when they took the cheese out and the money out, the rats, after 3 or 4 times, would quit running the maze. The graduate students would break in at night. Truly, because they thought they might have left money there. I say, I told you the reason why hope was in Pandora's box. It's not because it belonged in the box, okay? Prairie dogs have an incredibly complex language. They've done this thing, so you put a fat guy with a red shirt, and he begins walking through the prairie dog, up to the prairie dog thing, and they'll create words for fat guy in a red shirt. You change the shirt, it'll be fat guy in a blue shirt. Put skinny guy in a yellow shirt, and it changes again. And they could identify the words because they'd put fat guy in a red shirt, fat guy in a blue shirt, skinny guy in a red shirt, skinny guy in a blue shirt. And they started getting their language, right? In the book, Plant Intelligence, I say the chimpanzee that knew the most sign language was 350 words, but there's a new one now that knows 3,000 words. It's amazing. You know, so they're going like, yes, chimpanzees are highly intelligent. This chimpanzee has learned 3,000 words in sign language. But my question is always this: how many words of chimpanzee has the smartest primatologist learned? And the answer is 0. So which one's the more intelligent species, right? The chimpanzees teach the sign language to their offspring. They invent words for things that they haven't been taught. And you know what the first word they always invent is? I love this. I told you it's funny. It's for poop. Always the first word they create is the word for poop. I love them. They're just so cool. I mean, it's funny. Dogs add and subtract. Ravens make tools. So do alligators and crocodiles. Okay. Amoeba farm bacteria for food. Dung beetles navigate by the stars. Elephants can learn human speech. Dolphins use nonlinear mathematics in food seeking. Okay, intelligence is everywhere. It's just, I love these scientists going, are we the only intelligent species on the Earth? You know, perhaps out in space, there's intelligent species. And there's all these intelligent species around them everywhere. And they're going, get away from me. I hate cats. And so plants are similar. There's no difference. Plants are just as intelligent. Okay, plants possess language, tool making, culture, and so on. But we've been taught, you know, that they're really stupid. I mean, and it's that thing that I mentioned already. It's like a guy gets in a coma in a hospital and they go, he's a vegetable. It's like, you know, he used to be Tom, but now he's broccoli, right? It's like, no. You know, it's really insulting to the plants. You know, and if they want to make that kind of a analogy, it'd be, you know, air molecule, maybe, right? Oh, he's an air molecule. Okay, I'll work on that one. Perhaps my timing. So, you know, the common view is that plants are passive entities subject to environmental forces and organisms that are designed slowly, solely for the accumulation of photosynthetic products. However, plants have neural networks sometimes that far exceed our own. Let's see. You know, who was it that discovered the plant brain? Who could it be? Who was that? It was Darwin. In a book that the neo-Darwinists never read. And it's the root system, okay? Now in humans, our organ, the brain, holds our neural network, okay? And for plants, the soil holds the neural network, right? Our brain development is limited by the size of the organ and the cranial bone structure, right? Roots are not limited by any of that, okay? There's always somebody like that in the group. You know, you remind me of Jesus. And Jesus is talking to the crowd, and he's saying, stop, stop. You know, they're stoning that woman. He goes, stop, stop. Let he among you who is without sin cast the first stone. And this rock comes out of the back of the crowd and hits the woman in the forehead. And he goes, Mom, you're winning everything. So, PowerPoint. That is a photograph of the neural network in the human brain, part of the neural network in the human brain, okay? And neural networks like this, they're a meta pattern, PowerPoint. See the similarity, okay? And the root system is exactly the same. And it's not a little bit the same, it's exactly the same, okay? The root apex, the pointed ends of the root, are a sensitive finger, a perceiving sensory organ, and a brain neuron. Each root hair, rootlet, and root section contains an apex. Every root mass, millions, even billions of them. A single rye plant has 14 billion neurons. The human has 86 billion, 16 in the cerebral cortex. Larger root systems have more neurons. The older the plant, the more the neurons, and much more than the human sometimes. And if they're connected to a mycelial network under the soil, it becomes immensely large because you have a synergistic brain that will go extreme distances. Now, the thing is that's interesting, one of the oldest aspen groves, aspens, it's the root system, and they send up shoots, which we see call trees. One of the oldest known is 100,000 years old that covers hundreds of acres. Its neural network dwarfs the human by orders of magnitude. Okay? You can find this, same is true of many mycelial mats. Plants have neuron synapses and neurochemicals identical to our own. Researchers note the root apices harbor brain-like units of the nervous system of plants. The number of root apices in the plant body is high, and all brain units are interconnected via vascular strands, i.e. plant neurons, with their polarly transported plant neurotransmitters to form a serial neuronal system of plants. It's obvious that the number of root apices is extremely large. This feature makes the serial plant brain extremely robust, and the amount of processed information is immense. Anthony Trewavas, who's doing great work on plant neurobiology, says, learning and memory are two emergent holistic properties of such neural networks and involve large numbers of neural cells acting in communication with one another. Learning results from the formation of new dendrites. Memory lasts as long as the newly formed dendrites themselves. The neural network is phenotypically plastic, and intelligent behavior requires that plastic behavior, that plastic potential. Plants use the same neurochemicals we do, including one we don't, auxin. Their physiology is nearly identical to our own. And these neurochemicals that we use have been around for hundreds of millions of years. We only partake of them because they're present in the system. They were adapted for use in us as we were innovated out of the ecological matrix of the planet. Morphine, cocaine, alcohol, chloroform, serotonin, hallucinogens all affect plants identically to the way they affect us. And Gigadis Bose, the turn of the 19th century, did a lot of work on this. He was a remarkable guy. So what he would do is he would take a giant tree and he put a big tent over it, and he chloroformed the plant, and then he dug it up and moved it, didn't go into shock. Okay. He had ways of measuring the nervous movement, the nervous mechanisms of plants, quite brilliant. And so he would get trees drunk. He would water them with an alcohol water combination, and the trees would go exactly through what we do. First they'd get giddy and really happy, and then they'd begin to slur their speech, and then they would pass out and they would have a hangover the next day, right? So when apple trees drop their apples and they ferment on the ground, you see all the birds come and get drunk on it and stuff. When it rains and that goes into the soil, the tree gets drunk too. A lot of plants make berries, and yeah, the seeds are eaten, the berries are eaten, and the birds poop the seeds out and stuff and move the plants around the world. But the other thing they do, the plant makes its own alcohol to get drunk. Okay, everything likes to get intoxicated. I don't know why Americans can't grasp this fact. The Puritans were some sort of weird genetic hybrid. I don't know how it happened. No dancing, no singing, no drinking. Okay, well, seriously. No, what it... that was the serious answer. No, actually, Bose created these things that you'd have to read. Incredibly dry writer, but you'd have to read his books. And he was able to create these really rudimentary machines that could measure their nervous impulses and their behavior, okay? And basically, and then you just get into like his 12 books and you'll learn more than you ever wanted to know about that.
What was his name?
Gigadis Bose, B-O-S-E, one of India's greatest scientists. He trained in the empire. He came to England, went to Oxford.
How do you spell his first name?
J-A-G-A-D-I-S. There's still the Bose Institute in India. They still do some work there. Bose found that the plants responded identically to the human to these chemicals. They had the same effect on their nervous system. He would give them let's see, oh, I forget which one it was. He gave them some chemical that causes death in humans, and the antidote, so he gave it, the plant's going toward death, and he injects it with the antidote, and it corrected it just like it does in human beings. The vascular strands that support the plant body, giving its rigid structure, also act as the peripheral nerve system for the plant. Plant neurotransmitters move along that system, carrying information to the periphery, just as they do in us. Plant roots engage in finely detailed analysis of their environment and communicate with the rest of the plant via neurotransmitters. The above ground leaf structure is a very potent sub part of the plant brain. Trevavis says, given the plethora of signals that plants integrate into a response, autonomic responses do not occur. Signal perception is instead ranked according to assessments of strength and exposure. That's basically typical sensory gating as it occurs in all life forms. The plant actually chooses the optimum response from a plethora of alternatives. Potential responses can be rejected. The number of different environments that any wild plant experiences must be almost infinite in number. Only complex computation can fashion the optimal fitness response. The plant brain is highly plastic. It has neuroplasticity, just as our brains do. As new environmental demands are placed on the plant, it responds in part by generating new neural structures to process the information. Neural networks in wild ecosystems develop more complex and extensive neural networks than in the domestic plants. Trevavis makes a great point. He goes, yeah, no wonder you can't find this stuff in the plants you're growing in your laboratories. They're domesticated. You give them everything they need. The temperature's how you hold constant. There's no pests. They're couch potatoes. They don't need to generate any kind of massive problem solving. Plants possess sensory gating nearly identical to ours. That gating modulates as the neural network alters in response to environmental demands. You give a plant LSD, it gets high just like we do. Okay.
We get nothing from even catnip.
Somebody's been trying catnip. You didn't realize what you told us about yourself. The other day I caught her with a bag of catnip and she was rolling over it on the floor. Going, I want to get high too. It's important to remember that these neural networks of plants have memories and learning over long timelines. There's a guy, I think it's Frantisek is his first name. I didn't write it down. Baluska. He's the other great plant neurobiologist doing work now. He said, Baluska. He's great. As cells of the transition zone of the root are not engaged in any demanding activities, they're free to focus all their resources on the acquisition, processing, and storing of information. There's massive memory in plant roots, especially the old ones. Smart plants memorize stressful environmental experiences and call upon this information to take decisions about future activities. They plan ahead. They found that plants will plan up to 2 years ahead for things they're going to do. And they have that same saying in the plant world as they do in ours. Make plans and the gods will laugh. The Delphinians.
I had a whole bunch of lovely Delphins, gorgeous flowers on.
Well, of course it was the Delphinians because they are the offspring of Delphi. Gotcha on that one. They have very deep experience in identifying environmental pressures and generating adaptations. This is the essence of old growth. They carry the cultural memories of their species, and all of you felt the difference between the elder trees and the young. You can feel their wisdom and the accumulated knowledge base that they have, their awareness. I mean, it's not rocket surgery.
Would a young aspen have all the intelligence of this incredibly old?
They're different. They're all like little kids. There's occasionally some old growth aspen that'll get up about like this big, maybe 100 years old, maybe a little older before they die back. And you can feel it more in them. But the young aspens, they're just like little kids, like four-year-olds. That's why when you walk in there, you know, I used to love to take depressed people into aspen groves, because you take them in there and they all get happy because they're surrounded by all these kids going, and the aspen leaves move even when there's no wind. The old people in Colorado called them shakies, which I didn't like that term that much, but it does remind me of a joke. So there's this guy in a nursing home and he falls in love with this other woman, you know, and so they're having this affair kind of thing. Well, maybe he didn't fall in love. They're just having an affair. That's the way the joke goes. I'm sorry, I screwed it up. They're having this affair and everything, but one day he sees the guy from the back. He's sitting on a bench with another woman, and she's obviously doing something with her hands. And so later he comes back, and she yells at him, and she goes, what does she have that I don't? And he goes, Parkinson's. It's like,
if old plants have all this knowledge and that, can they can plan ahead? Why can't, or can they plan ahead and pass that on if they know that they're dying out or something? Can they pass that knowledge on?
They do pass on a lot of things. I don't know exactly what they pass on, but they pass on a lot of things. Okay, so I'll tell you about some of them a little bit. But killing old growth destroys the memory of millennia of adaptive learning. These old trees teach the young trees what they need to know to become elders. Okay? They learn on their own too, but they're teaching them all of the time. Plants teach others how to resist herbivores. Artemisia tridenta teaches neighboring tomato plants how to increase proteinase inhibitors in their leaves to stop foraging. They teach wild tobacco how to increase production of methyl jasminate to slow herbivore predation. They share what they figure out with each other. They're aware of everything that enters the region. I mean, think about it. They can't run. They can't hide very well. So they have to be extremely aware of everything moving toward them. They're really nice paranoids. So, you know, they have to be highly attentive to all life events that can affect them, and this includes mobile life forms such as humans. Okay, we are all generated out of Gaia. Gaia generates no organism at all ever out of the ocean of being except to fulfill specific ecological function or purpose. We are all kin. You can see from this we're kin. Okay? The same patterns that are in them are in us. And as many native people in the state said, we are their children. Okay. They care for us. Cooperation is a lot more fundamental than competition. Okay, now Gaian functioning, as I've mentioned, has two primary underpinnings, bacteria and plants. Bacteria are the most fundamental. The bacterial membrane is completely around the earth. It goes from several miles deep into the earth, at least, up to the edges of space. It's the largest ecosystem known, in a sense. Okay. I love Lynn Margulis, she was really hilarious. Bacteria have far more important things to do on this earth than to devour our tissues while we're still alive. Isn't that great? Drink our blood when we are old, or fight with us over who will eat our food first. Oh, I love there was this great line in the Gandhi film where it got me a great way of thinking about Christianity I hadn't got before. There's a scene where one of the minister guy crawls up on the roof of this train, and there's this guy, this Indian guy, he goes, oh, are you a Christian? And he goes, yes, I'm. He goes, I knew a Christian once. She drinks blood. Blood of Christ. And I thought, oh my God, that's how it looks to all those other people. We're like vampires. You know, every Sunday I have to drink some blood, otherwise I begin to lose my vitality. Think about it. I mean, it's weird. Yeah, if I can't get the blood, though, I eat his body. Oh, could I have the breast, please? Bacteria have far more important things to do on this earth than to devour our tissues while we are still alive, drink our blood when we are old and weak, or fight with us over who will eat our food first. Those who hate and want to kill bacteria indulge in self-hatred. Our ultimate ancestors, yours and mine, are bacteria. Not only are bacteria our ancestors, but also they invented consciousness. Bacteria is really the only life form on Earth. Lynn Margulis deserved the Nobel Prize. I'm really pissed off she didn't get it. It's just I will never get over it. But she got that all life forms are complex innovations of bacteria, okay, in more sophisticated blends. Bacteria are not really, and beyond that she goes, bacteria are not really individuals so much as part of a single global superorganism, which would indicate that we are part of a single global superorganism. That superorganism is in actuality an incredibly large community of highly intelligent interactive subparts. So she came up with this term symbiogenesis because she did this one great thing. Her two-year-old was very active. No, I won't, you can't make me. So she's very, very, very smart. She goes to school, University of Chicago, I believe it was. She's in her class, they're studying cell biology, and they're talking about the nucleus. And the guy's going on and on, yes, the nucleus, blah, 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 all this stuff. And she goes, yeah, but this cell has two nuclei. And he goes, the other one's irrelevant. And for the first time of anybody in that class, she went, wait a second. That's the stupidest thing I ever heard. She goes, why does the cell have two nuclei? Well, it turns out it has a mitochondria in the cell, which is the energy that powers our cells. And that mitochondria has a nucleus in it. And so she looked around and she found free, wild, living mitochondria and realized that there had been a blending of two organisms together that self-organized, that produced, they each had capabilities, but when they blended together, they made something more than the sum of the parts. Symbiogenesis, life from blending, okay? And so that was like one of the greatest, I mean, I think it's fantastic that two of the greatest assaults on neo-Darwinian reductionism came from women, Lynn Margulis and Barbara McClintock, okay? And then Jim Lovelock added his piece. I love, I talk in the book about Barbara McClintock more. A bunch of Nobel Prize winners came to see her in her laboratory and I think in the 60s, and she threw them out after 15 minutes because of their arrogance. Ooh, I love that. Get the fuck out of my office. And you know, they were like, she's mad. She's completely mad. Then she wins the Nobel Prize. I've always liked her. I believed in her work when no one else did. Okay, one of the most potent innovations of bacteria are plants. They're fundamental to the current climate of Earth. Again, that whole thing creates and maintains the climate which allowed our species to emerge. They are our ancestors. We are their children. So I'm gonna look a bit at some of the function in ecosystems. Ecosystems are all different kinds of sizes. You know, I tried to find out some really definitive definitions of these things, like, is that, like, did I repeat myself? Hey, watch the double positives, okay? So there's like ecosystems, ecozones, ecoranges. I couldn't really find a thing, but some are bigger than others. Okay, ecozones kind of are like continents, I guess. So smaller self-organized systems, join together to make larger ones, organs, okay? Organs join together to make organisms. Our focus for most of our life has mostly been on humans. It's most important to us. It's how we're wired up. We've been taught we're the most important. Everything else is less important. But really, it's actually we're, as Buckminster Fuller said once, we're just throwaway. We have this concept that we've been taught. It is one of the most dangerous concepts that we've taken in, and that is that the background of the world is static. We're the only organism possessing movement, and we move against a static background. Okay, that's literally insane. Okay, yet most of us believe that, in part because the background changes slower than we do most of the time. So the interesting thing is, when we have that concept of moving against a static background, and the static background is considered to have very little intelligence at all, but so when we tend to focus on something, so we could focus on this plant, so we begin focusing on organisms. Like the background is static, we have the most movement, but this has some movement too. Dog has some movement, whale has some movement, and we focus on the organism, so we're like organism-centric, right? We don't see the field itself. We consider the field in which they're embedded to be unimportant. But nothing could be more wrong, okay? Plants form communities of various sizes. There's ecoranges, biomes, ecotopes. So here's all the thing. Ecoranges, biomes, ecotopes, biotopes. And I never could quite figure out all the difference in those things. I read a bunch of books and I got bored. I looked on the internet on Google, and then it was too confusing. It was like circular. It made as much sense as a human being is a featherless biped. I mean, I love what happened after that. That happened in England. It was at the Royal Society, Stephen, or something like that. They would define a human being. A human being is a featherless biped. So a guy comes in the next meeting with a plucked chicken. And then they had a duel or something after, you know. The discrete ecosystems are similar to islands in the ocean. The edges are somewhat porous. Things flow in and out of it. But there's a community that comes into being as the specific ecosystem forms. In that region, all living organisms are tightly coupled together, okay? They're hooked together quite often through mycelial networks, and they have a rhythmic oscillation just as we do. Our heart field oscillates continually, and larger circadian rhythms also occur. All plants in any discrete ecosystem oscillate together. Each new plant brought in will begin oscillating with the others. It's like musicians who synchronize with each other, and there's a unique song that comes into being in every ecosystem. The song is not usually in our audible range, though some people can get it through synesthesia. Aldo Leopold said, "The song of the waters is audible to every ear, but there is other music in these hills, by no means audible to all." Okay. To hear even a few notes of it, you must first live here for a long time, and you must know the speech of hills and rivers. Then on a still night when the campfire is low and the Pleiades have climbed over the rim rocks, sit quietly and listen for a wolf to howl and think hard of everything you have seen and try to understand it. That cool feeling in the room again. Yeah. Something more than the sum of the parts comes into being, a living entity. Ecosystems have an intelligent consciousness that emerges into being at the moment of self-organization. We are not used to seeing it because we tend to look for a discrete organism. Ecosystems are intelligent, self-aware, and communicative. Okay. They are swarm intelligences. intelligent entities. They have specific functions in maintaining self-organization. They respond as a whole to pressures on the Gaian system, acting like our lungs or our livers, helping self-organization remain intact. We are only a special instance of a general phenomenon. Yep.
I just want, because I started to write something and I thought, am I getting this right? It sounded like that all planets are sending out this oscillation, this vibration.
Well, they're not sending it out, they're just oscillating, and that creates waves, oscillatory waves that we can experience, yeah. Okay. With ecosystems, there's a constant flow of energy and information into and out of them. They're tightly interwoven into the larger ecosystem of the Earth. Each acts globally. Globally. Yeah, he's really functional. Each acts locally. Maybe that's a new word, globally. Each acts locally, each acts globally. We're globally acting. My wife Tricia had this great thing. I was lobbying once, and she met this guy, this other lobbyist, and she said, she didn't know what she was saying. She has malapropisms all the time. He's not running on all senators. The ecosystem is part of a highly complex and redundant system for maintaining the homeodynamics of the Earth. Again, homeodynamics is what's accurate, not homeostasis. There is no static state. It's a dynamic state. They develop more complexity over time. The greater the complexity, the greater the stability. Tim Linton, quote, although reproduction of an ecosystem is clearly less faithful in its replication than reproduction of an organism, there is still enough short-term heritability of collective environment-improving properties for communities of them to spread across the global system. In his long-winded way, saying ecosystems reproduce. Okay? He uses big words because other scientists can't understand them well, and they won't pick on him. When they go, you're saying they reproduce? Well, sex is everywhere. It's possible to make relationship with ecosystems and interact directly. They literally are living beings, intelligent beings that possess characteristics, personalities, specific identities. Many ancient and indigenous cultures have talked about the intelligence of ecosystems through their own specific metaphors. Mountains have long been recognized as intelligent entities. I praise the mountain energy night and day. I walk the path that ecstatic humans have taken for centuries. In Korea, the mountain spirit is a fundamental entity within their culture. And many Buddhists would go live up there and build little places to live and spend their entire life working with the mountain spirit. In Southeast Asia, indigenous groups and many farmers traditionally honor sacred groves as the home of powerful entities. The Kuna and Embera Choco natives of Panama protect groves of old growth forest as the homes of spirits unique to that location. They say that their cultures will decay, fall apart, if they disrespect the spirits, if they allow the groves to be cut. Thoreau said, any civilization that cuts off its forests will fall. Okay. Once the groves are damaged, the spirits depart, and the culture that depends on them dies. Okay? That's their metaphor, but you see it fits into the whole concept of self-organization, right? This has been treated as superstitious nonsense. So again, to quote Hillman, it was only when science convinced us that the world was dead that they could begin their autopsy in earnest. Okay. But as usual, the indigenous people were talking about a concrete experience, something that can't be experienced by the statistical mentality. Masanobu Fukuoka, I love this guy, said there is no way of expressing the mountain which goes beyond a mountain. He's talking about the mountain spirit. It can only be perceived with a non-discriminating heart. Okay. We are moved by an indigenous group reverencing a sacred grove and the spirit that lives there. We're moved by a Korean Buddhist working with a particular mountain spirit, but very few of us in the West are willing to speak openly about ourselves working with an intelligent entity of an ecosystem. Okay? They can do it, we can't, because we are supposed to be responsible and grown up. The intelligent entity that emerges when an ecosystem self-organizes is a real thing, but very few people will say, yeah, I was hanging out with them the other day. It violates cultural norms. There's tremendous potential for shaming in it. How many environmentalists or earth researchers would be willing to write an article calling for human interaction with the invisible entity that comes into being when an ecosystem self-organizes and do so seriously? They would be laughed out of their career. We get into serious brain wobbles here for those of us in the West. But as Dale Pendle said, every true vegetalista has to meet Satyaruna, the forest person, face to face in the jungle. We have to cross over. And this is a fundamental part of it. We have to give up being a bridge and cross over, begin to work with the invisible intelligences with which we are surrounded every day of our lives, and that most definitely includes self-organized ecosystems. All human beings can feel that thing that comes into being at the moment of self-organization. When you worked with those great trees out there, you felt it. I mean, you had to walk way the hell across the field, and then you could feel it way far out. It's dynamic. Right? It's real. Okay, I never could get how a forester could cut down a tree like that. I just can't get it. Right? They had to be completely dead in their heart to do it. But you can feel it. An ecosystem has exactly that same kind of powerful presence, okay? That aliveness, that awareness. Thoreau talked about it once. Of course, everybody made up that he was, you know, speaking metaphorically. He wasn't. Here's what he said. I have occasional visits in the long winter evenings when the snow falls fast and the wind howls in the wood from an old settler, an original proprietor who is reported to have dug Walden Pond and stoned it and fringed it with pine woods, who tells me stories of old time and new eternity. And between us, we manage to pass a cheerful evening with social mirth and pleasant views of things. A most wise and humorous friend, whom I love much, but who keeps himself very secret. And though he is thought to be dead, none can show where he is buried. An elderly dame, too, lives in my neighborhood, invisible to most persons, in whose odorous herb garden I love to stroll sometimes, gathering simples and listening to her fables, for she has a genius of unequaled fertility, and her memory runs back farther than mythology. And she can tell me the original of every fable, and on what fact everyone is founded, for the incidents occurred when she was very young. A ruddy and lusty old dame who delights in all weathers and seasons and is likely to outlive all of us yet. Isn't that great?
Yeah, really.
A ruddy and lusty old dame. So all human beings can establish relationship with that thing that is more than the sum of the parts and engage in interspecies communication. You can use the heart field to synchronize with any self-organized field you encounter. Okay. and engage in a direct exchange of meaning without the intermediary of language. Okay. There's a rapid influx of meaning that flows through the field, is routed into the heart, goes into the heart, is routed to the brain for analysis. Again, the brain uses its store of memories, sensory experiences, cultural myths, learned information to turn it into usable information. Your system creates a series of metaphors to capture the meaning of what has occurred. Part of that, of course, comes from cultural beliefs. Each culture has a grouping of stories to explain such things. The underlying experience in every culture is identical, but when it emerges in its metaphorical form, it takes a different shape because each culture has different stories. And it's worked with as stored memory. The ancient Athenians had one series of metaphors, Romans another, groups in India another, in Asia another. And indigenous cultures have a plethora of them. Cultural metaphors combine with individual metaphors to turn the experience into usable information. And it just takes practice to learn your brain's metaphors, to learn how to correct for psychological distortion. Okay. So I often have people sit with plants like you've done. So I had these three young women once, and I had them sit with the bark of this tree, right, essentially. So one person came back and said, all I just kept hearing was the word soft, soft, soft. And the next person comes back and she said, all I could see was an image of a baby in an Indian cradle board. Y'all seen those? It's a board with a, and they work on their back, right? And the other one said, all that happened to me is I just felt really comforted. Okay. Well, see, the interesting thing is that tree's inner bark is used for treating diaper rash. See? They all got the knowledge directly from the plant, but it came through their metaphor, right? And you have some people like you, that, you know, they sit with a plant and they get like reams of, and then the plant showed me that in 1327, you know, right? And other people just, and sometimes I get that, other times I just get soft. You get, but the thing is, you have to trust what you get. As Gerda said, perception never deceives, ever. But that's why you have to slow the movement of these things down. Very, very slow till you can split the beat of a fly's wing into a million discrete moments. Because as soon as you're sitting with something, you're focusing on it through your senses, and you say, how does it feel? You'll get this intimation of mood or feeling, this burst. You may not be able to say what it is, but it'll be a discrete feeling that belongs to this thing and nothing else. It's part of the library of feelings you're creating. And right after that, something will come, okay? Some other little piece, soft or something, right? So you write that down, okay? Now, if immediately after, or you feel soft and then comforted, let's say, and immediately after that, if you start crying uncontrollably, then you freeze that in place and you start working with that. What's that from, okay? Now, that used to happen to me. I'd go around old growth trees, and I'd feel so comforted, I'd just start crying, and crying, crying, crying. And the reason I was crying is that because I never nurtured myself, you know? I never asked for anything I needed. I didn't believe it was okay to have needs, right? And so I basically was engaging in this kind of continual abuse of myself, right? And so I thought I had to earn the right to be alive. A lot of people in my liberal tribe suffer that problem. Okay? We have to do good works. And if we do enough good works, we will have the right to be alive. Right? And we get burnt out. But I would cry and cry and cry, and then that's my psychological response to what I received from the tree. So see, it's a matter of sorting that stuff out. And in the beginning, when you do this, there's a lot of psychological responses, okay? Because we've pushed all this stuff down in the unconscious, right? And it takes a lot of energy to keep it there, by the way. We're working very hard all the time to keep it down there. You know, it's just like anything, like, you know, it's like that thing where, because kids will say everything. It's like that thing I was talking about, you're going to the dinner you don't want to go to with somebody that's horribly boring. And the whole time you're there, like your child in you is going, hey, this guy's really boring. If he talks about his stamp collection one more time, I'm going to hit him. Yeah, look, no, this little tiny thing, that's what makes it special. I'm going to hit him. You get me out of here. Right? We press, repress all that stuff. It's like, you know, wouldn't it be just a lot more comfortable to go, you know, this is the most boring story I've, you know, here's a clue. Your anecdotes, they should have a point. You know, and we don't tell the truth a lot. It's like, Bly had this thing, he goes, the truth receiver in us turns itself off because it is surrounded by lies all the time and we don't allow it to say so. Our William Gass put it, he said, we've become used to the slum our consciousness has become. We've become used to the slum our consciousness has become. And, oh, that guy, I can't remember his name. Oh, I think it's in here somewhere today. But anyway, I'll read the whole thing. I remember the first part. It was that poet in, might have been Norway, that just won the Pulitzer Prize not long ago. He died, though, I think. I can't remember his name. Shoot. Anyway, he has this great poem, I love. I just remember the first part of it. He goes, these people come over to the guy's house to visit. And they walk in and they go, oh, your house is so clean. The slum must be inside you. Isn't that nice? So, perception never deceives, interpretation deceives. You experience a gestalt of meaning as a pulse flowing through the heart. Within milliseconds, the brain works to make sense of it. Milliseconds. Very fast, faster than that. So, I sit with Usni and all of a sudden, a young man begins walking up to me and tells me about the medicinal of the plants. But that wasn't the most important thing. He taught me that plants have been doing something for millions of years besides waiting for us to show up. The medicinal plants only work for us because they work for everything else. Okay? So the, you know, and as you've been getting into this, like when I did that thing, when I had you look at my lungs and you focused on them and said, how does it smell? You know, the smell just comes out of nowhere, right? That's a kind of synesthesia, okay? Your system turns the information into a smell, okay? And that smell is very discreet. One lung smells not good because it's still sick. The other one smells more like fresh flowers, okay? The Kalahari Bushmen say, they can smell spiritual development, right? They hear plant songs. They see sound. Synesthesia is occurring, where the senses combine together to form one unique perceiving organ, okay? Thing is, and we have to understand, Goethe did not lie. Barbara McClintock did not lie. Luther Burbank did not lie. Henry Thoreau did not lie. It was, they could not have lied to save their life. Okay. Goethe says, everything rightly seen, there's a new organ that develops. There's this guy I ran into on the net. I don't know anything about him, but he wrote some most amazing things that I have put in the new book. Immediately stole it. You know, most of the information in my book was stolen from reliable sources. He says, synesthesia is the mental function, our suite of functions, in which the senses run together, in which colors have a feel to them and tastes have a color. The phenomenon marks a total immersion in sense, when the observer is no longer in control, no longer separating sight, sound, texture, and becomes a part of his sensual surroundings. That is, the observer calls forth the world. This synesthetic perspective offers the possibility of actually engaging plants in communication, trying to understand, catalog, and analyze the slightly varying sense by which plant communication, by which plants communicate consciously, would surely overwhelm us almost immediately. Yet we can perceive far more than we can consciously articulate. Much of our brain's conscious function centers on filtering out the stimuli from our senses. Synesthesia means we can see and hear as well as smell what plants are saying in a process that involves our noses as much as our imaginations. So when I said, how does it smell, and you get a smell, that's the exact sensorial perception coming into play. And it's a moment of synesthesia. Nobody had to teach you how to do it. You do it automatically all the time. You don't need a PhD. You don't need to go to an ashram. You don't need to eat only vegetables and wind your legs around your neck. It takes time to learn this, how to unlock the meanings you're gathering, but really, it's a lot more fun than playing cards, right? It's really exciting. I mean, you go out, you get touched by meaning, go, ooh, what does that mean? It's like you're gathering meanings like a squirrel gathers nuts. You create a library of feelings. To do this with plants or an ecosystem means allowing yourself to immerse in its rhythms, synchronize with their oscillatory patterns, and let their reality move into yours. Let them speak in their own terms. Baudelaire, I quoted a little bit of this yesterday, this great Baudelaire poem. The natural world is a spiritual house where the pillars that are alive let slip at times some strangely garbled words. The natural world is a spiritual house where the pillars that are alive let slip at times some strangely garbled words. Man walks there through forests of physical things that are also spiritual things that watch him with affectionate looks. Man walks there through forests of physical things that are also spiritual things that watch him with affectionate looks. As the echoes of great bells coming from a long way off become entangled in a deep and profound association, that trembling and then the silence, you can almost feel that echoing. As the echoes of great bells coming from a long way off becomes entangled in a deep and profound association, emerging as huge as night or as huge as clear light. Odors and colors and sounds all mean each other. Emerging as huge as night or as huge as clear light. Odors and colors and sounds all mean each other, synesthesia. Perfumes exist that are cool as the flesh of infants. When you smelled that sweet smell, a perfume exists. Fragile as oboes, green as open fields. Perfumes exist that are cool as the flesh of infants, fragile as oboes, green as open fields, and others exist also. And others exist also, corrupt, dense, triumphant. The statistical mentality does not smell well. If you smell that, just when I said that, a number of you had a smell sensation.
Steel.
It's very, huh?
Steel.
Well, it's that, steel, but it's stagnant. It's been closed in a room for a long time, like pond water, for about 50 million years.
Nice living in pond water.
So. Yes, it is. And others exist also, corrupt, dense, and triumphant, having the suggestion of infinite things, such as musk and amber, myrrh and incense, describing the voyages of the body and the soul. Having the suggestion of infinite things such as musk and amber, myrrh and incense that describe the voyages of the body and the soul.